Hello, myself Rupali Saudhari and I will be teaching you the concept of sampling and its types. The topics covered are sampling theorem, sampling and reconstruction, analogy to explain it, then what are the types of sampling, differences in those types of sampling, what is Nyquist criteria, what if Nyquist criteria is not satisfied, sampling in frequency domain and the effects of sampling. Now let us see what is sampling theorem. It states that a continuous time signal can be represented in its samples and recovered back if and only if the sampling frequency fs is greater than or equal to twice the highest frequency component of the message signal W. That is, fs should be greater than or equal to 2 times of W. Then, this process of converting continuous time signal into samples is called as sampling, and the reverse process of converting the samples back to the original continuous time signal is called as reconstruction. The figure shows the process of sampling, where the gray line indicates the continuous time signal, the dotted line indicates the sampling pulse, and the red arrows indicate the sampled signal. So it shows that how a continuous time signal is converted into its sampled form. Now, let's see a puzzle where on one side you have a solved puzzle and on the other side you have an unsolved puzzle. Rather, these pieces make this puzzle, or this puzzle is made up of these pieces. Now I want you to think that, is there any analogy between the process of sampling and the puzzles? Well, the answer is yes. The solved puzzle represents the continuous time signal. The puzzle is made up of pieces which represents a sample. A continuous time signal is therefore nothing but the solved puzzle, and the unsolved puzzle's pieces are the samples of the sampled signal. So there is analogy between the sampling process and the puzzle. Now let us see what are the different types of sampling. First is ideal sampling. Now the figure shows a graph of x of t, which is nothing but our input signal with respect to time. Rather, it's a sine wave drawn with respect to time. S of t is the sampling pulse. It's a uniform pulse of constant amplitude varying with respect to time. And the third graph indicates the output signal which is drawn after the process of sampling. So it can be seen that the constant amplitude of the sampling pulse changes with respect to the amplitude of the input signal. So this indicates the process of ideal sampling. Now, second is natural sampling. X of t is the same, but now S of t has some short duration. Then the output signal will also have the samples with short duration, and the shape of the output is same as your input signal, or we say that it is naturally sampled signal. And third is flat top sampling. In this, we can see that x of t and s of t is same as natural sampling. But if you observe the output, then the samples are varying, but at one point they have a constant amplitude. Then I want you to think, what is the basic difference between ideal, natural and flat top sampling? Then the answer is, in ideal sampling, you have impulse at each sampling instant. In natural sampling, you have a short width pulse with varying amplitude. And in flat top sampling, you have a short width pulse with single constant value of amplitude. It can be very well seen in this graph. Impulses in ideal sampling, short width pulse with varying amplitude in natural, and short width pulse but constant amplitude for flat top sampling. Now let us see what is Nyquist criteria. Then the Nyquist criteria states that the sampling rate, means the rate at which you do the process of sampling, must be at least 2 times of F max or twice the highest analog frequency component. Rather, it states FS should be greater than or equal to 2 times of F max. Now, I want you to think that what if Nyquist criteria is not satisfied? What if sampling theorem is not satisfied? Then the answer is, if sampling theorem states FS should be greater than or equal to 2W, then if we see 3 different cases where FS is equal to 2W, then it will be an ideal case of sampling. If FS is greater than or equal to 2W, it will be a case of oversampling. And if FS is less than 2W, then it will be a case of undersampling. So the same theorem, but 3 different cases. One is when they are equal, one it is far more greater, and the third one when it is far more less. Now, if you represent the signal in frequency domain, then you will see that your message signal or a baseband signal x of t is like this, or this is the spectrum drawn for the baseband signal, which is a graph with respect to frequency. Then the second is the spectrum of sampling pulse S of t. So these are nothing but the sampling pulses distributed over frequencies. Having the sampling frequencies FS, 2FS, 3FS, 4FS, or on the other side minus FS, minus 2FS, and so on. Then after the process of sampling, you get the sampled signal, rather the ideally sampled signal represented in C, which shows that at each sampling instant, you have the baseband signal. At each sampling instant, you have the baseband signal getting sampled. So they are uniformly distributed, and there is a gap between each sample. Now lastly, you can see the spectrum of oversampled signal, where we can see that the samples, when distributed in the frequency domain, they are getting interfered at some places. This is interference caused due to the process of oversampling, and this is how the signal will appear. Now, what are the effects of oversampling? Reconstruction of oversampled signal becomes difficult. The spectrum shows huge interference amongst the oversampled signal, and due to this, the signal loses its information. Thank you. Bye.